Warning, this video is kind of bleak. Researching it made me cry twice. It's not often that science can bring you to tears, but when we're talking about the West Antarctic, the science is genuinely scary. And in the face of scary things, we need courage, not hope. So it's time to be brave. Come with me and find out why we have to be grown-ups about West Antarctic climate change. Sometimes I read a science paper that makes me feel physically sick. Which is no mean feat, because as a scientist, I train my brain to turn off my emotions when I read academic literature. But sometimes, despite those years of training, the horrifying reality of the conclusions really hit home. This is one of those papers. Naughten et al. Show that no matter what we do now, we are committed to a level of ocean warming that will irreversibly melt the West Antarctic ice sheet. That means completely redrawing the map. That means that this flat in North London will be quite a lot closer to the sea. In a minute, we're going to hear about these results direct from the source. But first, let me take you to one of the most remote and inhospitable places on Earth. The Amundsen Sea is a rough, freezing cold sector of the Southern Ocean surrounding Antarctica. This is where you'll find some of the world's most rapidly retreating glaciers, including the Thwaites and Pine Island glaciers, which combined contribute to around 5% of current global sea level rise. Thwaites matters particularly because it's thought to be a keystone glacier that would drag the rest of the West Antarctic ice sheet in with it if it were to collapse. And that would be a big deal because the West Antarctic ice sheet contains enough ice to raise global sea levels by between 3 and 5 meters. That's the kind of sea level rise that will keep cartographers employed for the next few centuries, simply redrawing coastlines. And this new paper has some pretty bad news about the future of the West Antarctic. I would normally summarize the key findings for you here, but you don't need me to, because today I can go one step better. Here's lead author, Dr. Kaitlin Naughten, with the top 3 points.
The top 3 take-home messages. First, we expect this area to warm in the future. The second point is that the warming will speed up. We found by factor of 3. And third, there's very little difference in between the different fossil fuel scenarios over the next century. So we don't have a lot of control, if at all, over how the melting evolves.
So ocean warming is going to accelerate in the West Antarctic, and there's nothing we can do to stop it. Well, as long as we're talking about this century, that is. More on that later. That warming is going to drive melting under the ice shelves around the region, which is likely to destabilize them and cause them to collapse, which would allow the entire West Antarctic ice sheet to flood into the ocean. So, how did they get to this conclusion? It's worth going back a few steps here because we're talking about the ocean warming up and melting ice from below. By definition, that means the ice has to be floating. You might be thinking, well, if ice shelves melt, big deal. Just like ice cubes in a glass of water, they don't add to the sea level when they melt. And you'd be right. Kinda. Ice shelves are floating platforms of ice that surround the continent and act like a cork in a bottle, holding back the glaciers that flow from the land into the ocean. If those ice shelves are removed, for example, when they melt so much that they collapse, much more ice can flow into the sea, adding to sea level. The loss of ice shelves means that the ice sheet, and that's the ice that isn't floating, can rapidly lose ice. And in West Antarctica, that's particularly problematic because of the region's geography.
West Antarctica is currently showing quite rapid loss of ice, and we are pretty sure that the cause of this is the ocean melting the ice shelves from below. West Antarctica is very vulnerable to ocean melting because a lot of it, the ice sheet is grounded, so it's resting on bedrock, which is actually below sea level.
As Kaitlin said, the West Antarctic ice sheet sits on top of bedrock that's below sea level, which means that as the ice sheet gets eaten away from below by warm ocean water, it retreats backwards, exposing more of its weak underbelly to warm ocean water, which drives more melting, and so on. It's a perfect example of a positive reinforcing feedback. The main cause of retreat in this example is rising ocean temperatures, which is exactly what Kaitlin and her colleagues were trying to explore. And they show that the warming we've seen to date is going to pale in comparison to what's in store. Their results suggest that the rate of temperature rise is going to triple over the next 80 years or so. And what's driving this projected heating is changes to ocean currents in the Amundsen Sea. As the climate warms, we expect more warm ocean water to be transported under ice shelves, wearing them away from below. At the same time, higher temperatures in the atmosphere will increase melting from above, as well as increasing the amount of snow and possibly rain that falls, and shifting wind patterns will amplify the changes expected in ocean currents. You might be wondering how we know these results are worth paying attention to. After all, it's only one paper, and one paper doesn't make or break the scientific consensus. But in a region and a scientific field as fast-changing as West Antarctic ice loss, the slow-moving scientific consensus can be late to the party. Besides, the research that's already been published already points to some pretty bleak outcomes for the West Antarctic. Several papers have already suggested that the Pine Island and Thwaites glaciers are destined to collapse, and brand new research I covered in my last video shows that even with current levels of warming, the West Antarctic ice sheet will disappear. And I hate to break it to you, but we're not going to maintain current levels of warming. The heat will continue to rise for some time at least. This new work by Kaitlin and her colleagues uses a pretty comprehensive and cutting-edge method to explore potential futures. And it joins the chorus of an increasing number of studies pointing to a pretty low threshold for tipping the West Antarctic into a new state. One thing that Kaitlin's paper didn't do was directly link the projected ocean warming and ice shelf melting to sea level rise. That's because her model doesn't explicitly include interactions between the ocean and ice sheet, but it agrees very well with previous studies that did do that using different methods. And unfortunately for us, if you use different methods to arrive at the same conclusion, you can be more sure of the results. The implications are pretty bleak. We're potentially talking about upwards of 5 meters of sea level rise over the next 300 to 500 years, with one or maybe two of those happening within the lifetime of kids born today. And already we're seeing homes lost to the sea on coastlines around the world. Already we're seeing people forced to relocate away from rising waters. Already, we're seeing a refugee crisis as people are forced from their homes. It may be too late to save the West Antarctic ice sheet, but it's not too late to take action. There's still time to plan how we will adapt to a world with new coastlines. What it means is that we have to adapt to the changes that are predicted and make some pretty difficult choices about which areas should be protected from the waves and which we need to abandon.
We need to prepare for some amount of sea level rise. It would be irresponsible to not do that. We are working hard on getting a handle on exactly how much sea level rise and how big the uncertainties are. But a world in which all the coastlines stay the same over the 21st century is just irresponsible. If we pretend that the sea level will stay the same until the ocean is literally at our door, we will have a refugee crisis. So we need to plan in advance and decades in advance for how all the coastal communities in the world really are going to respond to a sea level rise. Are they going to try and stick it out and build walls and defend against the rising seas, or are they going to abandon the area and relocate elsewhere?
It would be easy in the face of this news to think, well, f*** it. But this is no time to give up.
We shouldn't give up, because even if we can't stop the West Antarctic ice sheet from collapsing in the worst case scenario, we can still save the East Antarctic ice sheet, which has 10 times as much ice. We can still stop all kinds of other impacts of climate change from getting worse, like heat waves and droughts and extreme rainfall. It's easy for a scientist like me to think that West Antarctica is everything and is the whole world, but it isn't. It's just one impact of climate change. Climate change isn't just one thing. It's a whole set of interconnected systems. And we shouldn't respond just to a single impact of climate change. We need to look at the whole system.
As Kaitlin says, the West Antarctic is only one region of Antarctica, and one which has long been thought to be the most vulnerable. On the other side of the continent, the East Antarctic has a vastly bigger quantity of ice, and we think that it will stay relatively stable if we can keep emissions down. Besides, sea level rise is only one consequence of climate change, and one that's a very slow burner. We already have much more immediate concerns with the increasing number of extreme events. Comprehensive climate action can still prevent the consequences of things like drought, heat waves, floods, storms, and extreme rainfall from worsening. And if we think longer term, because the world won't end in 2100 and future generations will definitely thank us for it, we will start to see the impacts of our actions today. While we can't necessarily control whether or not the West Antarctic ice sheet collapses, we may be able to control how fast it happens and buy ourselves some more time to adapt. I have to confess that most of the time, I am pretty desensitized to the kind of bad news that I have to deal with every day as a climate scientist. Most of the time, the dramatic changes we've observed and predicted get reduced down to numbers. But for some reason, this one hit me like a ton of bricks. And if you're watching this channel, chances are that you have also experienced some of the grief that comes with dealing with the reality of this information. This is the point of the story where convention says you're supposed to give a glimmer of hope. But hope isn't always appropriate. Kaitlin wrote a great article, which I'll link in the description, and I was super inspired by the ending. In it, she talks about the need not for hope, but for something else.
When I first saw the preliminary results of this study, I was like, okay, this will make some headlines, but how do I communicate this? How do you tell this story? And this is the narrative that we have to give people hope. It kind of angers me because I think we also should be grown-ups because there's some stories which are just bad news and we have to accept it, and we shouldn't have the promise of a happy future dangling is the only motivation to solve the problem.
Courage is such a powerful way to put it, because in the face of objectively bad news, which is what we're going to be getting more of as time wears on, we are going to need something to motivate us to change that isn't the promise of a happy ending.
Courage looks like adaptation, looks like accepting that we might not have a hope of a happy ending. So we have to work with the ending that we have to minimize human suffering. Courage also looks like shifting our focus to a longer time scale. Everyone's focused on their own lifetimes or even shorter. Politicians are only looking ahead to the next election is what everyone says. So asking people to prioritize the way the world looks in 2200, 2300, 2500. It sounds extreme and ridiculous, but that is actually where we have the power, or so we think, to dramatically change the way the world's coastlines look. That's the control that we have. And just because we won't be alive at that time doesn't mean that we don't have a responsibility to the generations which are.
So let's be brave, be grown-ups, and take our future into our own hands, because it's our responsibility to do so. If you like this video, okay, maybe liked isn't the right word, if you found this video helpful, drop me a comment below. And if you want to hear more from Kaitlin, my full interview with her is available on my Patreon page, where you can also find a whole load of extra bonus material. Big thanks to my fabulous subscribers, including these top tier legends up here, for helping me keep these videos ad-free and allowing me to spend more time making them. And if you'd rather stay here and hear more about how climate change is reshaping Antarctica, you sadist, check out this video up here. See you next time.